Yeah. Hi, my name is Kim Harrison. I am currently a doctoral student at Roosevelt University, and I am here today with my colleague.
I'm Dr. Suzanne Dykes-White. I'm a professor of counseling here at Purdue University, Calumet.
And we are here today to talk to you about self-injury. Many other terms, you've probably heard this referred to as self-mutilation, self-harming, self-injurious behavior, self-inflicted violence. All terms to describe the same behaviors. And what I start out with here is, these are actually quotes from some individuals from internet blogs or online journals. And the thing I like to point out about self-injury is I think even as professionals, we sometimes have a misconception that if I ask someone what a typical self-injurer was, they'd probably say a 16, 17, maybe 15-year-old Caucasian female who is depressed and wanting attention and acting out. So part of my presentation and our presentation here today is to dispel some of those myths. So I'd like to have you look at the one up here in the top corner. It says, I usually injure myself in an effort to get my mind off terminating my life. In short, injuring is the only way I stay alive. This was written by a 30-year-old female who has been self-injuring for 21 years. If we do the math, that means she started self-injuring at age 9. Okay. And this one here, without reading the whole quote, you'll see though she's 33, been injuring since her teens, and she has her PhD. Some other things here, we have a 14-year-old male who says he loves to watch himself bleed. It relieves stress and it makes him happy. Master's student who says it hurts a lot, but it makes me feel something, and feeling something's better than feeling numb. And then the one we have down in the corner, I injure myself to try and calm down, to escape painful memories of my abuse, to control my emotions. And if we look at that, she's been injuring for 17 years and she's 23. Again, meaning she started at 6 years old. So right there we can see that self-injury is not just a behavior that is elusive or exclusive to teenagers. Just a very brief history in case some of you are not aware. The study of self-injury is actually very new in that major developments in the understanding of this disorder have only occurred within the last 20 years or so. However, Dr. Carl Menninger was the first individual to really begin to try and study self-injury as an issue separate from suicide. He began doing that back in 1938. It took until the 70s for mental health literature to begin to identify that there was a difference between self-injury and suicide. Up until that point, self-injury was just strictly viewed as a weak suicide attempt, a failed suicide attempt, attention-seeking suicide attempt. In 1983, two individuals by the names of Pettison and Cahan came along and they developed the first classification system to define self-injury. Relatively complex, several different variables you take into play to determine the lethality of the injury. What we go by now was developed in the 1990s, primarily by Dr. Armando Favazza, who's one of the leading researchers in self-injury in this country, and one of his colleagues, Rosenthal. They developed the current definition that most people accept for self-injury and the classification system that we use today widely to understand this disorder.